നമസ്കാരം. പൊതുകാര്യങ്ങളിൽ സജീവമായി ഇടപെടുന്ന ന്യായാധിപൻ, നിലപാടുകളിൽ വിട്ടുവീഴ്ചയില്ലാത്ത നീതിബോധം. പ്രസ് കൗൺസിൽ ഓഫ് ഇന്ത്യയുടെ മുൻ അധ്യക്ഷൻ റിട്ടയർഡ് ജസ്റ്റിസ് മാർക്കണ്ഡേയ കട്ജു, വെൽക്കം സർ.
My pleasure.
You're for the first time in Kochi?
I have been here on, I think, a couple of occasions earlier also.
How do you feel about this place?
Well, you have elected a beautiful mayor in your city. I saw her on television.
Okay. I would like to know your stand regarding that said controversies regarding Subhash Chandra Bose and Mahatma Gandhi. Do you still stick on the stand?
Of course. Regarding Subhash Chandra Bose, see, he was no doubt a patriotic person. In his youth, he resigned from ICS and wanted to serve the country. Later on, it seems that he became ambitious, and particularly after he was removed from the presidentship of Congress by Gandhi, he went berserk. First, he went to Germany and he hobnobbed with Hitler and Himmler. He wanted to become their collaborator, raise an army of Indian prisoners of war to collaborate with the Nazis. When that did not work out, he went by submarine to Japan and he became an agent of the Japanese.
And you were calling Gandhi a British agent?
Yes, because objectively a British agent, because you see, the British policy was divide and rule. Divide Hindus and Muslims. Now, ever since Gandhi came to India in 1915, 16 or so from South Africa, and up to his death in 1948, for 30 years or so, in almost every speech or article of his, which you can read in the collected works of Mahatma Gandhi, which is a Government of India publication in several volumes, in every speech or article, Gandhi propagates Hindu religious ideas like Ram Raj and Goraksha, cow protection, Varnashram, caste system, Brahmachar, etc. Now see, if you are a sadhu or mahatma sitting in an ashram, you can say anything you like. But once you enter into politics and start saying all this publicly, it is very dangerous, because see, India is a country of great diversity, and the percentage of Muslims in India before partition was more. After partition, the section went over to Pakistan. Now, if you keep on propagating these ideas publicly, what effect is it going to have on a Muslim mind? Will it not drive him towards a communal organization like the Muslim League? How can a Muslim remain in a party whose leader is constantly propagating Hindu religious ideas, Goraksha, Ram Raj, and so on?
But he was a secularist.
He was not secular. This is a myth. If you keep propagating Hindu religious ideas in political meetings, how are you secular? You are driving the Muslims towards the Muslim League. Will it not have that effect on Muslims? Can they join an organization where the leader is propagating Hindu religious ideas? Cow protection, Ram Raj, Varnashram. He was a strong supporter of the caste system. He only opposed the untouchability, which was an extreme fringe. Otherwise, he was a strong supporter of caste system. How can Muslims join such an organization? And therefore, Muslims were driven towards the Muslim League. And did it not serve the divide and rule policy? And therefore, objectively, are you not a British agent? I'm not saying he was subjectively a British agent. I'm not saying
he was a religious person. Every man in India has the right to believe in any religion, no?
That's right. In your home, you can do it. But in political meetings, when you are saying all this, see, Gandhi perhaps thought that to get mass support, I have to appeal to religion, because India is a religious country. He did get mass support. But mass support of Hindus, you will not get. How can you get mass support from Muslims when you are preaching Hindu religious idea? So therefore, are you not serving the British policy of divide and rule? India got independence not because of Gandhi, but because in the Second World War, the Germany attacked Britain and possibly may have conquered Britain, but for American help. and Americans gave help to England, but by extracting their price, they said to the British, "All right, we will help you, but then you will have to give us a slice of the Indian market. We also want to invest in India and we want raw materials from India. You will not enjoy India alone. You have to open up the Indian market." So 1947 was really just opening up the Indian market for American investment also.
That's a different point of view.
It was because of American pressure that the British left India, not because of Gandhi. Nobody gives up his empire without an armed fight.
Parliament passed a resolution against your statement regarding this.
Parliament can do anything. In fact, see, if you have read Alice in Wonderland by Lewis Carroll, there is a character, the Queen of Hearts, who says, whenever she sees anybody, she says, "Off with his head, off with his head." So somebody said, "But what about first holding a trial and giving a verdict?" She said, "All that can come later. First, cut off his head." So Parliament has behaved like that towards me. Without giving me a hearing, they have condemned me. See, the first principle of natural justice is that before condemning somebody, give him a hearing. They have not given me a hearing. So they have behaved like the Queen of Hearts.
Okay.
And I have challenged their resolution. My petition is pending in the Supreme Court. Mr. Gopal Subramaniam and Mr. Shalan Farasat. Yes, it is fixed, I think, on 3rd January.
Let us come to other topics.
All right.
Our country is going through a major crisis period under Modi government, I think. Atrocities against Dalits and backward classes, intolerance towards writers, even freedom of expression is not protected. How do you assess the entire situation?
You see, Mr. Modi came to power on the slogan of Vikas, development, which meant to the young people particularly that millions of jobs will be now created. They thought that Vikas means thousands of factories will be set up and millions of jobs will be created. Young people want jobs. So cutting through caste and religious lines, the youth particularly voted en masse for the BJP led by Mr. Modi. But after winning elections, it is found that the jobs are not there, because jobs can't be created by shouting slogans. Jobs are created when the economy is rapidly expanding. But Indian economy is stagnant. Rather, if you have noticed the latest figures, there is a decline in manufacturing and so on, which means the jobs will be reduced. So people were taken for a ride. It was all a hoax, this Vikas slogan. Then BJP will have to fall back on its old formula of instigating communal riots. Because you see, problem with BJP is this. You are from South India.
Yeah.
I would like to tell you.
Kerala.
Kerala, all right. I'll tell you about big states like UP, Bihar. Now, the base of BJP is the upper caste Hindu vote. And upper caste Hindus altogether, Brahmins, Rajputs, Vaishyas, Bhumihal, they are altogether 15-16%. You cannot win an election on 15-16%. You require above 30%. You need not get 50% because others are divided. But if you get above 30%, you can win an election. But certainly not on 15-16%. So the problem with BJP is they cannot win elections.
Bihar has given a shock treatment now.
In Bihar, this is the reason, because Modi wave has dissipated. Because people have seen through this hoax of Vikas, there is no Vikas.
And our writers are protesting now, giving back their awards and all.
Yes, they are rightly protesting. They are rightly protesting because India is a country of great diversity. We have to live together harmoniously. Otherwise, we will be fighting with each other all the time. So, secularism is absolutely essential for this country. And therefore, I agree with the writers. People, all patriotic people, must fight against communalism. It is a great danger to the unity of our country. So, So I agree with that.
Regarding beef ban, is it not against our fundamental rights?
See, there were judgments of Supreme Court upholding beef bans on the basis of, I think, Article 47 or 48 of this. But I don't agree with the judgment. People should have a right to eat what they want. I myself eat beef, of course, where it is legally permitted. In Kerala, it is permitted. I had for lunch and dinner beef yesterday. I am a Hindu Brahmin, by the way. I see nothing wrong.
There was a recent issue with a Kerala house in Delhi.
See, again, it was a issue, a deliberate provocation by certain vested interests who want to spread communalism in the country, polarize society, divide society on the basis of religion. This is all anti-national, all work of certain Western interests who are in fact enemies of the nation. Because in our country there's so much diversity, so many religions, so many castes, so many languages, so many regions, cultures. Only way we can be united is secularism and giving equal respect to everybody. We must be tolerant, we must respect each other. This was the policy of the great Emperor Akbar, whom I regard as the real father of the nation, not this fraud called Gandhi. Emperor Akbar, his policy of Sulh-e-Kul, which means universal toleration and respect for all religions, that is why the Mughal Empire lasted so long. And in fact, that is the foundation of India. So he is the real father of the nation. He appointed Hindus to highest posts, like Todarmal was appointed like the finance minister of India, Birbal and Man Singh were army commander. He gave equal respect to everybody. And that is the only way you can run this country.
Corruption is spreading like a cancer in the whole system of governance. While coming to Kerala, hope you have heard about a recent bar case which led to the resignation of a minister.
I don't know about this particular case. Let me tell you one thing. Corruption will continue in this country for another 10-15 years at least, and I'll tell you why. You see, India is presently passing through a transitional period in our history, from feudal society to a modern industrial society. At presently, we are neither totally feudal nor totally modern. We are somewhere in between in our history. Now, feudal society had a certain moral code of what is good, what is bad. That has been largely shattered because feudal society has been largely shattered. Modern industrial society also has a moral code. If you go to America or Europe, people there do not tell lies. If they make a commitment, supposing they'll say they will do this thing day after tomorrow, they will do it. You don't need to take it in writing. There's no bribery to policemen or tax people. They have a certain moral code. Now, India is neither feudal nor modern industrial. So it has no moral code. The feudal moral code has been smashed because feudal society has been smashed. But industrial society has not been set up. Therefore, the industrial moral code is not there. So there is a total moral vacuum in India. Now it is just free for all. You grab money by hook or crook. That is the order of the day, that you make money, whether by cheating or something, it's not looked down upon.
Even judiciary is not that transparent. You were pointing your fingers against judiciary also.
You see, when I joined Allahabad High Court as a lawyer in 1971, there was no corrupt judge in Allahabad High Court, and perhaps no corrupt judge in any high court in India, nor in the Supreme Court. Today, my guess is roughly 50% of the higher judiciary has become corrupt. Lower judiciary, of course, was corrupt even before that, is 80% corrupt. Higher judiciary, my guess is around 50%, which means High Court and Supreme Court, 50% has become corrupt. It is very sad, but this is the truth. Mr. Shanti Bhushan, the senior lawyer of Supreme Court, who was former Union Law Minister, filed an affidavit in the Supreme Court, I think, 5 or 6 years ago, that half of the previous 16 Chief Justices of India were corrupt, and he gave their names. And after that affidavit, some more Chief Justices of India were retired, they were also known to be corrupt. His present Chief Justice of India, Dattu, is known to be corrupt. I have written so many Facebook posts and blogs on him.
What's your idea to bring out these sitting judges outside the system?
Ousting the corrupt sitting
judges?
Yeah,
corrupt sitting judges.
It's very difficult to do it. You see, firstly, the brother judges, they defend themselves. There was one judge who, Supreme Court judge, he is no longer Supreme Court judge now. He, you know, a case was not listed before him. It was listed before another bench. But he got the case listed before himself and passed an order in favor of a party. Land in Bombay worth 1,000 crores was given to that party for 30 crores. And president of the Supreme Court Bar Association, Mr. Dushyant Dave, protested against it. And a writ petition was filed by Mr. Shanti Bhushan in the Supreme Court asking for a registering of an FIR against that Supreme Court, retired Supreme Court. But that was dismissed because, you know, often other judges, they defend their colleagues wrongly. They should not defend a corrupt judge. But that is the tendency that let us bury the corruption under the carpet. They say, oh, otherwise there will be a scandal in this. But why should you bury corruption under the carpet? Rather, it should be exposed. And when I have been speaking against corruption, so then Chief Justice of India Lodha said, oh, some people are trying to defame the judiciary, meaning me. So I issued a statement that does corruption by judges defame the judiciary, or does exposing corruption defame the judiciary?
Regarding appointment of judges also, you were pointing out something, caste credentials is there.
See, caste consideration should not be there. I don't believe, you know, first of all, I don't believe in this reservation policy on the basis of caste. What to say of judiciary, not even in admission in educational institutions or government service, that this, all this should be stopped. Yes. For poor students, poor people, you give special benefits of whatever caste. He may be poor Dalit, he may be poor Brahmin, he may be poor Muslim. You give him special help. A poor boy may not be able to buy books to study. He should be given help. But I am not in favor of this caste reservation, either in judiciary or government service or even for admission in education institution. All this must be stopped now. This is just for vote bank politics. These people who are supporting it, they just want their vote bank. I'm not in politics, so I don't care whether you're happy with me or unhappy with me. What I believe to be the truth, I will say.
About gay marriages, I would like to know your view.
See, I'm against Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code, which makes gay relationship a criminal offense. It should not be a criminal offense. If somebody wants to be gay, that's his private business. So I want Section 377 to be deleted.
But you also believe that it is unnatural?
Yes, it is certainly unnatural because, you see,
how can we say that? It is
biological. I will tell you how I say it. See, there is a powerful force in nature, powerful principle that we individuals will die, you and I will one day die, but the species must continue, human race must continue. Now, this is why there is the sex instinct, so that when man has sex with a woman, then a child is born and the species continues. There is a powerful force in nature. You may like it or dislike it, but it is there. So it is only when men and women have sex that children are born. But if a man has sex with a man, or a woman has sex with a woman, the species is not continuing. So what is natural? You know, can you deny nature? Can you deny that you are a woman and I am a man? Can you deny that there is attraction between men and women? This is natural. I mean, if you want to deny everything, then deny that 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. Keep on talking nonsense. But this is natural. Attraction between men and women is natural. In fact, I was in India, my daughter is in California, when I put up this blog that this is unnatural. So she telephoned me, because in California there are a lot of this gay movement, there are demonstrations and protest marches. I said, wonderful, that if I say openly that this gay is unnatural, I will be beaten up. Because it, you know, and I'll tell you the real thing. Problems of the world are economic, like unemployment, prices, healthcare, etc. Malnutrition. Now, if you are unable to solve this real, these are real problems, then you divert attention to some non-issues, like lives of film stars, astrology, cricket, etc. And gay business is also one of the really non-issue. It's not such a serious issue. All right, for some people it may be an issue, but it's not such a as big an issue as the issue of unemployment, issue of hunger,
poverty.
That those are the major issues. But you are deliberately diverting attention from the real big issues to a much smaller issue, if you can call it an issue at all. Deliberately, this is done.
I believe it is an issue.
Same way as the media, I'm sorry to say you are in the media.
Yeah, I recall your statement.
Deliberately divert attention of the people from the real issues which I have mentioned.
Yeah, I recall
your
statement.
To lives of film stars, that which film star is having a love affair with which film star, cricket, astrology, these babas, you people deliberately do this.
Yeah, in Sheena Vora case, I recall your statement.
No, just imagine, for 2 weeks, many television channels kept showing Sheena, 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 Sheena. Then when that subsided, then Indrani, 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 that today Indrani is in depression. Today morning, Indrani had biscuits for breakfast. This was what being shown on your television screen.
It is going to be TRP rating based journalism.
Yes, and TRP, and also you have been given instruction by your owners that you avoid the real issues. You project the non-issues or subsidiary issues as if they are the real great issues, and great issues you sideline, you depict as if there are no issues at all. Are you not befooling the people?
Yeah, I agree with you, but at the same time, social issues are coming out to media.
Sometimes for sensationalism you do it, but it is just for creating sensation, breaking news, TRP rating and all that. More often I see film stars and, you know, cricket. You know, is cricket relevant? That you say that no, unemployment is not relevant. Price rise is not relevant. Is whether India has beaten New Zealand in a cricket match. You are showing cricket match after cricket match. Whole time, many channels are showing cricket. How does it matter whether India beats Pakistan in a cricket match? Will it reduce poverty? Will it reduce unemployment? This is just diverting attention of the people from the real issues. Real issues, you say, they are no issues. Whether India beats Pakistan in a cricket match, that is the real issue.
While coming back again to Kerala, there is a current issue. Boys and girls are not allowed to sit together in some of our colleges.
That is stupid. Boys and girls should be allowed to sit together so that, otherwise, you know, where there are separate schools, then at a late age, you know, at one time boys and you get married, you are bound to come together. Then you will not know how to behave with each other.
But our Minister of Education is supporting this view.
He is stupid. Who is this minister? What is his name?
Abdurab.
He is stupid. That is a totally foolish thing. As I told you, let boys and girls grow together and they know how to interact with each other in a proper way. Otherwise, they won't be able to interact with each other in a normal way. They'll feel totally, as if I am in the presence of a stranger, they won't know how to talk, how to behave. That's stupid.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much for this cooperation. See you again.
Okay. Thank you.